Yeah, 25.
There we go.
Oh, and I need to, last thing I need to do is to make this pinned. All right, well, welcome tonight to our Wednesday evening Genesis deep dive Bible study here at New Beginnings Christian and Missionary Alliance Church in Poughkeepsie, New York. I'm Pastor Danish House. Welcome tonight is March
28th?
30th.
Is it
30th?
30th.
Wow. Yeah, it's my clock is reset. My is blinking 12 o'clock inside my room. Welcome to everybody who is here by Zoom, everybody who's here in person, and of course, if you're watching this on YouTube after the fact, we're glad to have you here. If you're watching this on YouTube after the fact, we're joking about power loss. Our church lost power over the weekend due to equipment malfunction, and so we had to have service elsewhere, and so I'm still kind of discombobulated from that, but glad to have you guys here tonight. Let's pray, and then we'll jump into our study. Lord, thanks for this chance for us to be together. Thank you for your word, which is majestic and wonderful and holy and incredible. And Lord, thank you that even when we do lose electricity, that doesn't mean that we lose your power, and that your Holy Spirit is at work in us and among us, and that we can have church, we can have Bible study, we can have all these things through the power of your Spirit, and that we can be together. So I thank you for the unity that you give us through the electronic means, but Lord, we thank you also for the unity we can have in the Spirit. We love you, we trust you, we ask for your Spirit to fill us as we study your word, so that we can hear what you have to say to us tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, so there's been three big things in my life over the course of the last week. One is that we had the missions conference. So that was Sunday evening, and I was with a missionary all day Monday, and I went to him on Tuesday. So that was a huge bit of my life. The second thing was we had a children's ministry huddle that took place last night. I hosted the children's ministry specialist who came. I was here last night with her, and she stayed at my house and took her to Upton Lake Christian School, where she did the same thing for pastors and children's ministry leaders from a lot of different churches. So that was a big thing. And then the third thing was, of course, that the church lost power, and we did a lot of work and rescheduling things. So that, all that to say that there's no handout today. The handout that I normally give, the prep that I normally do for sort of a pre-study Bible studying and teaching, that's not going to happen tonight. We're going to dig right into the passage, which I am ready for. I wasn't ready to give you more teaching tonight. So next week, we'll be back on that schedule. But this week, that was not possible. I just didn't have enough me to do that this week. So far. So, pray, I appreciate your understanding. So last week, we started studying this story of the stealing of the blessing. And this is, you remember that we were digging into this passage about Isaac and Rebekah and their two sons, Jacob and Esau. And Isaac wants to give his blessing to his eldest son, Esau. But Rebekah loves Esau's younger twin, Jacob. And so Rebekah schemes to make it possible for Jacob to get Isaac's blessing instead of Esau. So with that started in our manuscript on page 44, line 23, and we set the end of our passage at page 48, line 17. So page 48, line 17 is the end of our passage. Last week, we were able to study up to page 47, line 2. So by that point, what had happened was that Isaac had been deceived, and so Jacob deceives Isaac at his mother's instruction, and Isaac gives the blessing to Jacob, right? So that's what happened. Now, Esau had shown up to receive a blessing after Jacob had gotten it, and Isaac realizes he's been deceived. So that's where we're starting it up. And Isaac says in page 47, lines 1 and 2, "Who was it then that hunted game and brought it to me? And I ate it all before you came, and I've blessed him. Yes, and he shall be blessed." So that's where we ended off. So we're going to start off with page 47, line 2. "As soon as Esau heard the words of his father." So as we're doing manuscript Bible study, you remember that our three-step process to manuscript Bible study is to look, to listen, and to live. Or if you prefer, observe, interpret, and then apply. Or if you prefer, what does it say? What does it mean? And what does it mean to me? Okay. We spend the bulk of our time looking, observing, asking, what does the text say? And the reason we do this is because we believe that the Bible matters, right? That the words of the Bible matter, that God superintended the things that are recorded here, not just the events that are described, but the recording of it, so that we could learn what he wants to say, that the Bible is not just a storybook, but it's actually God speaking to us about something. So we spend time observing so that we know what it actually says. We might have seen movies about these stories and events. We might have heard sermons about these stories and events. We might have read children's books about these stories and events, even scholarly books about these stories and events. And some of the stuff in it might be true, some of it might be false, some of it might be confused. It's not until we deal with the text as it is that we can really start to engage with what God wants to say, right? As long as we're responding to what someone else has said about it, we're not actually engaging the text. So we need to ask, what does the text say? We spend the bulk of our time in that simply because we're really bad at that. That's our least skilled at that. And because there's so much other noise in our heads about us. Second is to listen, to interpret. What does it mean? Because facts don't interpret themselves, right? If looking and observing is to gather the facts about the passage from the passage, facts don't interpret themselves. Anybody who tells you that I don't interpret the text, I just obey the text, does not know what they're talking about, right? If you're messing around, like, let's say you're in that table back there where all the bad people sit, and you're nudging your table mate and whispering, and I say stop. What does that mean? Right? Well, it might mean stop whispering. It might mean stop, elbowing your partner. It might mean stop disrupting the class. It might mean stop breathing. And you could make a plausible case for any of those things. But what did I really mean? Well, that's the task of interpretation, right? The fact is, they were doing what they were doing at that table, and I said, stop. Those are the things that we observe. But how are we going to obey that? Well, we need to first understand what it is that I meant by saying stop. That's a simple example, but it's even much more important and much more complicated in the scriptures. We need to interpret what does the scriptures mean. And our principle here in this class of a manuscript study is that the interpretation is always based on the observation, right? And the closer the interpretation is, the more tightly based it is on the observation, the better the interpretation is, right? The fewer things we're making up, right? the fewer things that we're sort of twisting, the better the interpretation. The more it closely fits the facts, the better the interpretation. And then, and what we believe is that this stuff above the line, this is stuff that's true for everybody, everywhere, all the time, right? What the text says is the same. You could go to Uganda and read the Bible in Uganda, and it says the same thing that it says to us here in the United States. You can go back 500 years, right, into Brazil, and the text 500 years ago says the same thing that it says today in Poughkeepsie in 2022, okay? This is always the case for everybody. The facts are there to be observed by everybody. The interpretation also is the same for everybody. Now, it doesn't mean that we're all going to interpret it the same way, but what it means is the interpretations we come up with should be transcultural, should be transhistorical. They should be things that are so closely associated with the text that it's an obvious implication of the text. And when it becomes personal is when we go under this line and we try to live it out. We try to apply the scriptures to our lives. What it means now is what it meant then. What it meant then is what it means now. But what it means to me is different every time, because I'm a different person every time I look at scripture, and I got different situations going on in my life, and what Chris has going on in his life, what Mary has going on in her life are very different. And so the application, what God is saying to you today, that's going to be different for different people and at different times. Ideally. Now, one thing that I will say is that interpretation and observation are often a factor of what lenses you're wearing, right?
Perception,
right? Ideally, the facts are the same for everybody and every time, and interpretation is the same for everybody and every time. But the truth is, we have biases that are part of our lives, okay? It's very valuable, for example, to have men and women reading the passage together, because men are going to catch certain things that correspond with their experience. Women are going to catch other things that correspond with their experience. And so it's very valuable. It's very valuable to study the scripture with people from another country. And to say, okay, well, what things that I'm observing do I observe because I'm an American, right? And what things would a person from Kenya observe that I miss entirely, right? So there is benefit to different people's experiences, and your experience doesn't determine what the text says, but you might see things that I don't because of your life experiences. If a kid sits in here and looks at the scriptures, they're going to come up with certain things out of the scriptures, but you know, me as a 50-year-old man is going to see different things because of my experience. Now, what they see might be perfectly legitimate. What I see might be perfectly legitimate. I might not have seen what they see, and they might not see what I see. But as long as it's really there in the text, we're golden, right? And so there's a benefit to doing Bible study together. There's a benefit to doing Bible study with a variety of people. And there's a benefit to doing Bible study even with people from different historical eras. And so that's where things like commentaries come, right? So we don't use a commentary here, but once you've done your study, it's very valuable to go in, pull up a commentary on the scripture and see what people throughout history have said about this passage and say, okay, well, I see that we saw the same thing, or they saw something different in the year 300 AD than I do now. Here's a quick example. When I was studying for this past Sunday's sermon, I talked I talked a lot about cultural context. We talked about this last week, historical and cultural context. I talked about it in the sermon because it was very key to the passage. But one thing I didn't share was that one of the early church fathers, not in the I guess early church fathers is generally used for as a term for people who lived, leaders of the church who lived up to 325 AD. This was late. This is a guy who was a little bit later, and I can't remember his name, unfortunately, but he was talking about how cultural context works in the context of scripture. And he said, well, obviously, the scriptures that tell us not to get drunk don't apply today. That's what he said in the year 400 or 580. And his view of cultural context was that all of the commands about drunkenness don't apply anymore. That was for them back then, right? As we were saying in 400 AD. I think a lot of us would be shocked to hear anybody say that. Of course, passages about drunkenness are for everybody, everywhere, all the time. But in 400 AD, this early church father believed that no, drunkenness, that was an issue back then. We don't have that issue anymore, right? So different historical context, you can get different, viewpoints. And it's not to say that if they believed it 400 years after Christ, it's more true than what we believe or less true. We have to submit all of our interpretations to observation and ask, okay, how does this fit with what we see in the text? I wasn't going to teach you anything specifically. This is just, I want to go over look, listen, and live every time so we have that background, and I felt it was useful to do this. So anyway, there you go. Any questions or thoughts about that, about cultural context and about observation with other people? Online, say something on. Chime in, our Zooming friends. How many of you believe that scriptures against drunkenness can no longer apply? Yeah. Just wondering. All right, so let's go into our text and we will look. Let's look carefully and see what it is that we see. Hopefully you've done some study of this passage already. You've had your manuscript with you. If you're watching this by YouTube and you need a copy of the manuscript, send an email to church@newbeginningscma.org, and we will send you a copy of the manuscript. So what did you guys see? Starting at 47, line 2. What stood out to you?
Esau is very upset.
How do you know this?
He's begging his father for a blessing.
Begging him, yes. What makes you say begging? So I don't see the word begging in here, but you use the word begging. Why do you say begging?
He cried out exceedingly with great and bitter cries.
Yep.
Over and over again.
Yes, repeatedly.
Yeah.
Yeah, he keeps coming back. he tries to give arguments against his brother's character, right? And then he even just says, look, whatever you got, I'll take it. Mm-hmm. So I think begging is an excellent word for what Esau does. And it's very emotional, and he's crying with a great and bitter cry. Yeah, excellent. So Esau begs. I'm going to put that up here as an observation. Great. What else did you see?
Well, Isaac knew that he had come to him deceitfully, taking away his blessings. But he also knew the prediction that, you know, the junior would rule over the older.
Right. So we've talked about this before, that there had been a prophecy that the younger would rule the older. In this situation. But and Isaac knows that that's God's intent, but Isaac also is upset that Jacob deceitfully took the blessing.
Yeah. But Esau feels he's been cheated, even though he gave up his birthright.
Okay. Right. So Esau feels cheated. He feels cheated. So there is a distinction between the blessing and the birthright. Okay, so that's important to know. Those are two separate things. And this is, so where does this fit in Lucullus and Lib? This is still observation. Getting a definition for something, that's still observation. It's not interpretation. So historical context often goes into the look category. And this is what we're talking about here. A birthright was the idea that the firstborn son in a family has the right to twice the inheritance of any of the other children. Okay, so if you have four sons, okay, you have, you know, Joe, Dave, Max, and Larry. Okay, Joe is your firstborn. When you die, typically, if all else being equal, you divide your inheritance, your estate, into five pieces. Okay, you have four sons, you divide it into five pieces. You have piece number five. Okay, Joe gets two pieces, and Dave, Max, and Larry each get one piece. Okay, that's the birthright. In this case, Isaac has two sons, and so he divides his estate into three pieces, okay? And Jacob now gets two, and Esau gets one. So Esau gets half as much as Jacob does. Jacob gets twice as much as Esau does because of the birthright. It's transferring the right to a double share of the inheritance. Okay, that's what the birthright is. The blessing is something different. And we can see that from looking at this passage. Right? The blessing is like a prayer or like a prediction of the future. And actually, it can be a little tricky even to figure out which of those is more accurate. Let's look back on page 46 at the blessing that Isaac gives. Page 46, line 14, starts the blessing he gives to Jacob. He says, "See, the smell of my son is as the smell of a field that the Lord has blessed. May God give you of the dew of heaven and of the fatness of the earth, and plenty of grain and wine. Let peoples serve you and nations bow down to you. Be Lord over your brothers, and may your mother's sons bow down to you. Cursed be everyone who curses you, and blessed be everyone who blesses you." Okay? And it says nothing about share of the inheritance. It says nothing about dividing up the estate. None of that. What it is a prayer or a prediction about the future. Notice he says things like, "Let peoples serve you, and may God give you," which are prayers, okay? But he also says things like, "Cursed be everyone who curses you, and blessed be everyone who blesses you," which is more of a prediction. Here's what's going to happen. So the blessing and the birthright are two different things. Esau knows he's been cheated out of the birthright. And now he's been cheated out of the blessing. So here's what happens, right? So Esau says in 47, line 5, "Is he not rightly named Jacob? For he has cheated me these two times. He took away my birthright, and behold, now he has taken away my blessing." So talk to me about that. Is Esau right? No. Did Jacob take away his birthright, and did Jacob take away his blessing?
He took away the blessing.
He took away the blessing.
He didn't take away the birthright. He gave it up.
He didn't take away the birthright. Esau sold it. Yes. Okay. So this is important, right? As we're looking at what Esau says here, Esau's evaluation of the situation is not accurate. Okay, his emotions are clouding his recollection of things. And just, you know, I don't blame him. That's certainly what I do. You know, I always feel I'm in the right, right? The Bible says in the book of Proverbs that that we always believe the first person to tell the tale, right? Let's say there's a dispute between Mary and Sue. Sue comes to me, she says, "You don't believe what Mary did." Well, of course, I'm going to say, "Oh, that's awful, right? Mary's a terrible person." I believe you because you're the first one to tell the tale. And then Mary comes to me and says, "Whoa, wait, no, that's not what Sue said. Here's what happened." And now I have both sides of the picture, okay? Well, who's the first person you hear every story from? To you, right? In any conflict you're involved in, the first person who tells you who's at fault is you. And you know who's at fault? Them, right? So Esau, of course Esau is going to paint this picture in a way that's favorable to him. Esau says, he doesn't say a word about his own responsibility. He just says, "Jacob took away my birthright. Now he's taken away my blessing." I'm going to stop talking. What did you guys say? Well, seriously. How about somebody on Zoom? Folks on Zoom, what's something that you noticed here in this part of the story that was interesting to you? First person to chime in gets the birthright.
Well, going down a little bit further, the thing that sticks out to me is that when you grow restless, you shall break his yoke from your neck.
So how would you, it's great, good observation, Kevin. How would you characterize that bit? What is that bit talking about? What sort of thing is it?
I guess, I mean, it, to me, I guess it seems like, you know, at some point you're gonna not want to deal with him anymore, and you're not going to want to serve him anymore.
Yeah. Is it a prayer or is it a prediction?
A prediction.
Definitely a prediction, right? This is Isaac predicting the future. Here's what's going to happen in the future. Yeah, very good. And what's going to happen is you are not going to be content being ruled by your brother. I think that's a pretty fair prediction, right? I don't think it takes the amazing Kreskin to predict that, right? Or Gene Dixon or whoever the horoscope writers are these days. That's the idea that Esau would not submit calmly to Jacob's lordship. That's a pretty easy bet there. Yeah. But so it's probably true. Yeah. Great. Thanks, Kevin. Good observation. So I'm gonna put that up as Esau will grow restless. Yeah, very good. What else did you see?
Well, I saw Esau pressing his father for a blessing, hoping that it would be positive, and he got a negative blessing.
Yeah, okay. So he got a negative blessing. Be careful what you wish for, right? I mean, in some ways. He wants a blessing so badly. He's like, "Give me whatever you got." And his dad's like, "Well, what I got left is not good, right?" Is it entirely negative?
No.
So let's talk about negative and positive here. What are the negative things that are involved in Esau's blessing?
Sounds like he's not going to have a lot.
Not going to have a lot of stuff.
Right.
Okay. Live away from the earth. Live away from the fatness of the earth. And
away from the
dough. And he's going to live by the sword.
Yes.
Okay, yeah.
You shall serve your brother.
You shall serve your brother. Not a happy thing, right? But when you grow restless, he says, you shall break his yoke from your neck. Mm-hmm. I'm going to ask you to excuse me. I need to run for just a second, okay? I'd like you to do is to do some observation while I'm gone. I'll be right back.
Yeah. Something's tickling your throat.
Yeah.
I know my sinuses were not happy this morning.
I wonder if it was a custom that the father could only give one blessing. Because when Esau was asking, you know, have you but one blessing? Why couldn't he bless them both?
Yeah, and why should one get such a generous blessing?
The first, the one gets the birthright gets the generous blessing.
And then, I guess so. Yeah. Definitely doesn't seem fair. I mean, the way things are now, most people, I think, would split what they had between their children, you know, equally, not...
That's culturally that today what we should do, but not culturally not then.
Right. I'm going to get a drink. I'll be right back.
I got some cough drops.
Oh, okay. I need to have some, but I don't have any. Thank you. Who's on? Who's up there? It's so quiet. It's funny reading the Bible this way, isn't it? It feels like we're reading some kind of television show or something.
We're all dealing with human emotions, which haven't changed much.
Yeah.
Oh, did he come back up? I see MNA, CMA.
I don't know why he said that wasn't us, because that's all over. That bleed with the cross and the left.
Church at New Beginnings.
Which is kind of weird because every time that we get emails from the church, it just simply says
church office.
But I don't know if you can, like, I replied that, but I don't know if I can start an email saying church office. Well, I've never tried. Oh, this feels much better. Thank you.
And then the YouTube would be the same thing, or?
Yeah, yes.
Because I didn't get a chance to.
Yeah, you can go on YouTube, or you can, when you go on, when you look up the website for New Beginnings, you'll have a live stream site also, but you can get live stream on YouTube.
I apologize for that. And a small, immediate personal emergency. All right, thanks for your patience, guys. Let's get back into it. So hopefully you've been doing a little bit of observation, you picked up some more things. But I want to ask you this. We talked about a negative blessing. What is a negative blessing? Do we have another word for a negative blessing?
I'm going to say it's a curse.
It's a curse.
But this doesn't sound like a curse. It's not strong enough.
I would call this a mild curse.
Okay.
Right? I call this a mild curse. So let's think about this. Under what circumstances? Under what circumstances do we know that a curse will come on people who are related to Jacob in some way? What Isaac just gave his blessing to Jacob, and in that blessing, Isaac mentions cursing. How does that work?
Anybody who curses will be cursed.
Anyone who curses Jacob will be cursed.
Oh, so
has Esau cursed Jacob?
Yes.
Sort of, yeah. Right? He's a cheat. He's taken away my birthright. He's taken away my blessing. He is rightly named Jacob, or deceiver. Okay?
Or grasper.
Grasping deceiver, yeah. So Esau gives a mild curse against Jacob. Well, immediately he receives a mild curse back. I think that's just an interesting cause and effect, right?
Yeah.
Very good. Okay. Get a little bit of time. What's your next observation? What's the next thing you saw? Online or here in the room?
Esau hated Jacob now.
Esau hated him. Where's that?
Line 15.
Now Esau hated Jacob because of the blessing with which his father had blessed him. Okay, so hatred. Hatred is now the result of all of this scheming, right? This doesn't build the love between the members of this family. This actually is driving wedges between the members of his family. Esau hated Jacob. And what's the result of
such strong hatred that he plans to kill him?
Okay, hatred that leads to murder, or at least a murder plot, right? This is how far this has gone, right? Hatred and murder. Now, we're studying the book of Genesis. The book of Genesis starts off with a good creation, and everything is harmonious, and sin disrupts that creation. And the first thing that we see as a result of that is two brothers who hate each other, right? One of them hates the other brother enough to murder him, right? And that has to do with the blessing as well, right? In that instance, God accepts Abel's sacrifice, but does not accept Cain's. It's not exactly a curse and a blessing, but there's an interesting parallel there with Cain and Abel, right? There's an interesting parallel here that this sin creates a situation in which hatred and murder are possibilities. Very good. What else do you see?
Well, we're eavesdropping again as we go further down the line.
Where do you see that?
But the words of Esau, her elder son, were told to Rebecca.
Okay. Rebecca has spies.
There we are again.
Yeah. Yes, okay. Yeah. So Rebecca, through the grapevine, right, hears what Esau has said. And Esau has said what? Esau said, the days of mourning for my father are approaching, and I will kill my brother Jacob. He's not going to kill Jacob while Isaac is alive. We talked about this last time. Isaac was, what, he said 80 years old, 100 years old? 100 years old?
Yeah,
100. Isaac was 100 years old. Esau says, my dad's about to kick the bucket, right? He's just about dead. Here's one of the ironies of this story. Esau is about as good at predicting his father's death as Isaac is. Both Esau and Isaac expected Isaac would die soon. Mm-hmm. Isaac is not going to die soon. Isaac will die much, much later. Isaac has still decades and decades of life left to him. So we don't know that at this point in the story, but it is a little ironic, right? That Esau says, look, as soon as my father dies, Jacob dies. It's also interesting that Isaac and Esau share a similar perspective on Isaac's lifespan. Isaac and Esau share a similar perspective on a lot of things, right? They're tight. And so where does Esau get the idea his dad is dying? Probably from his dad, right? Good. Yeah, okay, so, and they tell Rebecca what happened, and so she's got this inside knowledge now. And what's her response? Like, what is Rebecca think should happen? What does Rebecca want to have happen now? What's her solution to this problem?
Separation.
Yeah, right. So Rebecca's solution here is to separate Jacob from the family, right? So further family division, right? And what else?
Send him away to find a wife.
Okay, so she doesn't say that to Jacob, but who does she talk about a wife for Jacob to?
Isaac.
So finally, Rebecca and Isaac come face to face. And Rebecca says to Isaac, I'm afraid that Esau is going to kill Jacob. Or does she?
No, she didn't say that.
She didn't say a word about that.
No. She's being manipulated.
So separate and manipulate, right? This is Rebecca's strategy. It sounds a lot like the strategy that got them into this mess, mm-hmm. right? We're not gonna talk honestly about what's going on. We're going to lie. I wouldn't actually classify this as a complete lie. We know that from the beginning of our story that Isaac and Rebecca did disapprove of Esau's wives. But that is not what is in the forefront of her mind. She's not sharing her mind, her heart with her husband. Actually, interesting bit about what she does say to Jacob, though. She says, there's a couple things that she predicts, right? She says, your brother will be angry forever. Okay, stay with him for a while. Actually, in the Hebrew, it's, I think she says 3 days. Okay, so the translators translate this as a euphemism. They translate it as a figure of speech. Stay with him for a little while, right? And your brother will eventually stop being angry with you. He's going to, in fact, she says in line 23, forget what you've done to him, right? Mm-hmm. He's going to forget what you've done to him. Forget
I doubt it.
What you've done to him. Right. Yeah. So a couple things here. Yeah. So the first thing is Esau likely to forget? No. This is a tough prediction to believe it's going to take place. And the second thing is, Rebecca is like, I didn't have anything to do with it. This was all you, Jacob, right? You schemer. Look what you did. You cheated your brother out of the blessing. Rebecca doesn't take responsibility for her actions, just like Esau didn't take responsibility for his. The other thing I think is interesting, I was pointing out line 24, why should I be bereft of you both in one day? Why does Rebecca think that if Esau kills Jacob, she will lose Esau? It's obvious why she loses Jacob, because Jacob is dead. Why does she say, I'll be bereft of you both on one day? What does that mean, not in an interpretive sense, but in a looking sense? What does it mean, why should I be bereft of you both in a single day?
Because Esau would be punished for the murder of Jacob.
Yeah. Right. This is not a society with a legal system, right? There's no police officers. There's no judges, right? But there was justice, mm-hmm. right? And there was a sense of right and wrong. There was a sense of punishment for your actions. And what I see here is she's concerned that if Esau kills Jacob, Esau will be put to death as well. Mm-hmm. And probably rightly so, right? Mm-hmm. Great. What else? So I'm on page 48 now. Look at 48. What do you guys see on page 48?
No, I think it's going to send Jacob away, tell Jacob to go away. Supposedly to get a wife. I mean, that's all he knows. He believes Rebecca.
Yeah, right. So this suggestion that Jacob should go to her brother and find a wife there, it finds good soil in Isaac's heart. And Isaac's like, oh yeah, sure, that's a great idea. Yeah. Why would Isaac think this is a good idea?
He doesn't want Jacob to marry a Hittite woman either.
Right, exactly. He doesn't want Jacob to marry a Hittite woman. We've seen that was important to his father, Abraham, right? It was important to Abraham that Isaac not marry a Hittite woman. And so, this is something that carries on that tradition. And of course, that's where Isaac got it wrong too, right? I mean, Isaac got his wife from Rebecca's brother and father. So going back there makes a lot of sense.
Pastor?
Yes, Beth.
Rebecca says that she loathes her life because of the Hittite women. Now that is pretty strong language. Makes me wonder what those women did to make her life so miserable.
Yeah. The text doesn't tell us, does it? Right? The only thing it tells us is back on page 45, right? Page 45, line 1, that Esau married Beeri the Hittite and Basemath, the daughter of Elon the Hittite, and they made life bitter for Isaac and Rebecca. So there's a bitterness there to life as a result of these daughters-in-law.
Were the Hittite Jewish?
No, they were Hittites.
So there's the problem.
Yeah, right. So
because if they have children, those children are not Jewish.
Well, so that's a level of technicality that doesn't show up for another few hundred years.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Okay. Actually, none of these people are Jewish. Jewish is not a category until Jacob has his name changed to Israel.
Okay.
So none of them are from the nation of Israel yet. But they aren't part of the clan. They're not part of the family. And the Hittites definitely are a family of their own, a clan of their own. And the Hittites have a religion of their own.
Yeah.
And the Hittites, yeah, right. So the Hittites have a political structure. And so it is They're somebody else. They're not us. Whoever they are, they're not us.
They don't worship the same God.
Right. Right. And that is going to make your life better. Mm-hmm. Right. And it is. It's a tough thing. When your kids marry outside the faith, it's a tough thing. And that's what Rebecca is saying here. She says, I loathe my life. And Bev, you're right. This is very strong language, right? In fact, she says in line 3, if he marries a Hittite woman, what good will my life be to me?
Yeah, almost like she would consider suicide.
Yeah, right? And it's strong. That's strong. And I have no reason to doubt that she's telling the truth, right? She's not telling Isaac the whole truth. She's not telling him the reasons that she told Jacob. But I have no reason to doubt. And the reason I don't doubt that she's telling the truth is that back at the beginning of the story, we know that this is true, that they made life bitter for her. So there's truth mixed in with her deception here, with her manipulation. So Isaac responds, and Isaac, okay, good idea. Isaac called Jacob and blessed him and directed him, etc. So let's talk about this little structure here. This is an interesting structure, linguistic structure, when it says that Isaac blessed Jacob and said, okay, or said, or blessed and
directed.
Okay, so indirectly. Blessed and directed. Okay. Then we get the directions, right? So then we get the quote of the directions. Don't take a wife from the Canaanite women. Arise and go to Paddan Aram, to the house of Bethuel, your mother's father. Take as your wife from there one of the daughters of Laban, your mother's brother. That's his directions. And then we get, God Almighty bless you and make you fruitful and multiply you that you may become a company of peoples. What is that?
The Abraham.
It's the blessing.
Hmm? The blessing.
Yeah.
Abraham blessing.
It is. So this is the Abrahamic blessing, right? Now, here's the question to us literal-minded Americans, okay? How many times did Isaac bless Jacob?
Yeah,
okay. So when it says he blessed him and directed him, is there a blessing that happens then? And then the quotation later is another blessing? No, this is a Hebrew construction having two verbs, okay? He blessed and directed, okay? But those two verbs are one action. Okay, this is a very common construction. Okay, I'm going to give you another Bible story where this is even more important. It's a story of David and Goliath. Okay, when David, what does David do when he kills Goliath? He takes a stone, puts it in a sling, slings the stone, and Goliath hits Goliath and falls down dead. Okay, and then it says, and then David killed Goliath and took Goliath's sword and cut off his head. How many times did David kill Goliath? Once, right? He only killed him once. But it says that he killed him and took the sword and chopped off his head. It could easily be that Goliath was alive when his head was taken. Right, that what killed Goliath was not the stone, but it was the sword. But the stone not denounced. Okay, it's taking two verbs to mean one action. Blessed and directed is one thing. So he gives him directions and blessing, and this whole quote that comes after is this, right? I only point this out not because it's going to change how you interpret this passage. But you'll see this construction again and again and again and again and again and again in the Old Testament. So watch for it. Watch for this two-verb construction that really just means one thing. It's a fun little thing that you'll notice as you go through the passage. Bev said to me the other day, hope it's not wrong to quote you, Bev, but Bev said to me the other day, she said, I've been studying the Bible all my life, and I'm seeing new things now that we've learned how to study the Bible in this way. This is one of those little things that I want to just put in your head that you'll from now on, as long as you keep this in your mind, you'll see this again and again in the Old Testament. It'll be fun. You'll enjoy it. All right. So he blesses him and directs him to go. And he gives him the, like Chris said, the Abrahamic blessing. Abraham is even mentioned twice in the blessing, right? May he give the blessing of Abraham to you and your offspring with you, that you may take possession of the land of your sojournings that God gave to Abraham. Isaac may not have been on board with blessing Jacob 3 pages ago, right? Isaac may have wanted Esau to get the Abrahamic blessing, but now he explicitly gives the Abrahamic blessing to Jacob. This is an explicit reference to Abraham. Very good. What else did you see? We got a couple more minutes to observe and then we'll move to interpretation.
Jacob left.
So Jacob left, right? He goes to Padan Aram. He goes to Laban, the son of Bethuel the Aramean, the brother of Rebekah, just like his father said. Okay, so Jacob is gone. What happens still back at the camp? The drama is not over, right?
Yeah, this has got me kind of confused here. Because Esau takes himself wives from the daughter of Ishmael.
Yeah.
But I don't know if he was trying to make things right or he was still doing it out of spite because Hagar was Egyptian.
Right.
And so, you know, I was trying to figure out
So
the motive there, whether he was trying to atone for marrying the Hittite women or whether he was just continuing despite.
Let's poll the crowd. People online, what do you think? When Esau takes as a wife an Ishmaelite woman, what was his motivation there?
Get approval from his parents.
Wanting to get approval from his parents? Yeah. That's what Mary said too. Wants to get into his parents' good graces.
You think it's spite?
You think it's spite? Yeah. I mean, what does the text say?
Didn't Esau also have a Hittite wife?
He did. He had 2 Hittite wives. Esau had 2 Hittite wives. And the Hittites are Canaanites. So Canaanites is a big word, and Hittites are under Canaanites. So Hittites are a Canaanite tribe. So he has 2 Hittite wives, 2 Canaanite wives, and he goes and takes an Ishmaelite wife. Now, Ishmaelites are not Canaanites. Ishmaelites are Abrahamites, because Ishmael is Abraham's son. So they are much more part of the family, right? They're children of Abraham. So I'll take, you know, Mahalath, the daughter of Ishmael, Abraham's son, the sister of Nebaioth. Now show me my way. So now I got 3 wives. So you weren't happy with the 2 I had before. So I'm going to take 1 more that you hopefully will be happy about. I don't know. I don't know if personally I would say that this was out of spite, but I would say it's a bizarre thing to do, right? It's a really bizarre thing to do because he doesn't, it's not like he puts his other 2 wives away, which would also be a problematic thing to do. But, you know, okay, now before my wives were 100% unacceptable and now my wives are 67%. Right, or something like that. I don't know, but it's whatever it is, it seems to me to be kind of a very lame and ill-conceived response, right? It's not what one would expect of a person who is a follower of God, right? It just isn't of the character of a follower of God. Now I say that provisionally, because we're about to get a story where Jacob winds up with four wives. So, we'll have to deal with that when we get to it. But it's also important for us to remember, and we talked about this a few stories ago, that what the New Testament says about Esau is that Esau was driven by his impulses. When the New Testament looks back at Esau, the New Testament says that Esau was driven by specifically his ungodliness and his sexual immorality. Those are the things that the New Testament refers to when it talks to Esau, talks about Esau. It looks at Esau as someone who was ungodly in his food and his sexual immorality. Those are the things that Esau gets criticized for. And it's not hard to see why that is the judgment of the New Testament when you read this passage. Just another note here, and then we'll move to interpretation. How old are Esau and Jacob at this time? It's not easy to tell. And actually, you probably don't have a way to calculate it yet. But here's the deal. We know that when Isaac calls Esau into his tent to bless him, Isaac is 100 years old, which means that Jacob and Esau are 60 years old each. Okay? They're twins. They're both
40 years old.
Huh?
They're 40 years old.
They're 40 years old? Did I say that? Huh? So they were born when Isaac was 60? Okay. Well, let's take that. I have Isaac back here and look.
Was it 44, the last line says when Esau was 40 years old.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very good. Okay. So that's at least the lowest bound, is it? Is that they're 40 years old. Here's the deal. We're going to, much later on, get an age for Jacob later when he leaves Padan Aram to come back to his father. We get his age. And we're told how many years he was in Padan Aram. Okay? We aren't told the age he was when he leaves for Padan Aram, leaves to go to Padan Aram, but we are told how long he's been there and how old he is. And if you do the math, Jacob, right now, when he's leaving home, is 77 years old. Okay? I just want to put a pin in this, okay? Jacob is 77 years old when he leaves home. A couple things about that. One is, the story kind of squishes some of the details together. It feels like, okay, Jacob and Esau are 40 years old, and they're still 40 when Jacob leaves. But there could have been 37 years over the course of this story. Okay? It's not super important, but it's just one of those things where it's like, okay, if we pay close attention to what the Bible is saying, there's things there that we don't always see. If you read a children's book of this story, in the illustrations, Jacob is in his 20s, which is, you know, that's how old you are when you get a wife, right? Because we want to say to our kids, well, you know, get married in your 20s, right? But Jacob is 77 years old when he arrives in Padan Aram. So, yes, well, he's carrying on the family tradition, right? Carrying on the family tradition of having his kids at an older age. It's you know, what that means is that Jacob is older than anyone in this room when he leaves for Padan Aram. Okay? I'm looking at our Zoomers. I don't know how old you are, Bev. Are you 77? Huh?
Are you asking if I'm 77?
Yeah, how old are you?
79.
Okay, all right, so Bev, Jacob is 2 years younger than you, right, as he leaves home in this story.
That's just wild.
Yeah. Yeah.
So age doesn't really mean anything to God.
Yeah.
Which makes me feel good because I'm getting up there.
Yeah.
You know, society was so different back then, because when it said that Rebecca told Jacob and he was 40-year-old, I thought to myself, now I wouldn't be telling my 40-year-old son. Oh, and Keith is older than that, of course. Yeah. But at 40, you wouldn't be telling your kids what to do usually.
No, you're right. You're right. It is a very different kind of thing. And the imaginations we have in our mind when we read the story, the pictures in our mind are not necessarily accurate. Now, it's possible that Jacob was 40 when he deceived his father. Okay. If that's the case, then it's been, then Esau's been angry with him for 37 years before he leaves.
Long time.
That's a long time.
Yeah.
Maybe, though, Esau was 40 when he took those wives. And there was a space between when he took the wives and when the blessing happened, the stealing of the blessing. But somewhere in there, there's 37 years that we don't know exactly where these events take place. That's just a little thing, but it's a fun one.
It's cultural again.
Right, cultural background, right.
I think I'll get married when I'm 77. That'll be my goal.
Can I do the wedding?
Yes, you can.
All right, good.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll make it a day.
Right. You got it. Well, you gotta pick a guy first. Before the date.
Who's ever around?
Because he might not be available on the date that you pick.
Hope I can pick somebody younger. Well, I want to marry this 77-year-old man.
Well, you know, I'm not gonna say, I don't know. I don't know. It's a hypothetical and I'm not willing to engage. Okay, let's take a step back. We've spent time observing, now it's time to interpret. As we look at this passage, what is this passage about? What are the themes of this passage? What does it mean? Does anyone want to take a stab at giving us a theme from this passage?
Deception can lead to jealousy, hate, and murder.
Yeah, okay. Deception can lead to jealousy, hate, murder. Absolutely, right? This is a moral lesson, right? Here's a moral of this story. It is don't deceive, right? Deception carries these negative consequences. Absolutely. Somebody else, what's another theme that comes out of this passage?
Parental blessing is important to children.
Yeah, okay. That comes right out of the Esau begging thing, right? Parental blessing is important to children. Even 77-year-old children. Right? I am 50 years old. I'll be 50 years old this year. From time to time, my father passed away 18 years ago, something like that, 17 years ago. I'm not doing the math, I'm trying to think of where it was. But there are times, a lot of times in my life, when I wonder, would my father be pleased with where I'm at, with what I'm doing? Would my father approve of my life? Right? I'm nearly 50 years old. I still want my father's blessing. Even though I know, you know, I have no way of getting it, he's passed away, it's still something that I long for. And when older Christian men say to me, you're doing a good job, it means a lot to me. It really does. Especially the men that I respect, I feel like, okay, this is really great. It is. It's an important thing, right? Parental blessing is important to children. I also think that, you know, just to put a pin in Isaac a little bit, which he deserves it, is that Isaac could not see any way to bless both of his children.
Yeah.
And there's probably cultural context in here that I'm not fully grasping, but I gotta believe you can bless both of your children somehow, right? I've got two kids. I'm blessing both of them as best as I can. And so I hope that the blessing doesn't just go to the firstborn in real life. I want to bless both of my kids.
We were discussing that while you were out.
Yeah,
I didn't see that. And, you know, I was wondering if it was a cultural thing at the time. Or...
I assume it must be. I haven't studied that question. But I assume it must be a cultural thing. Because it doesn't make any sense any other way.
Mm-hmm.
It's just too bizarre. The only other way it makes sense is that Isaac was a doofus. Yeah. I'm open to that. All right, so deception can lead to jealousy, hatred, and murder. Parental blessing is important to children. What else? What other themes do we have in this passage? Some of the questions that we often ask about interpretation are, what do we learn in this passage about God? What do we learn about people? What do we learn about worship? Right?
I was going to say favoritism divides a family.
Oh, amen. Amen. Favoritism. Divides a family. Absolutely. Now, the story the stuff we're covering today, it's connected with what happened last week. Like, so that's one story.
Yeah.
This pulls in some things from the last week's stuff, but that's the same story. Absolutely, favoritism divides a family. Do we learn anything about God in this section of the passage?
Whenever the blessing of Abraham is mentioned, or any blessing, it's good things,
yeah,
that are from God.
Yeah, okay, very good. Yeah, so definitely this idea of blessings from God maybe we might say the blessings from God continue even in the middle of human drama. I'm using the word drama because the words that are in my mind are not words that a pastor says on live stream. But you know, there's all this junk, and yet the promises of God continue, right? One of the Sue's favorite themes in Genesis so far is the promises of God, right? Sue's always reminding us of the promises of God. And here, especially with this explicit connection to Abraham in the end of it, the promises of God, the blessings of God, they continue even in the midst of all this human junk. They continue. The book, Jake, what did it do? Jacob deceived his father, right, cheated his brother, and yet the blessing of God continues. Now, it's not that he's being rewarded for his cheating and deception, but, and his cheating and deception will cost him a lot,
yeah.
Okay? He's gonna pay, but the blessing of God continues, and the promise of God continues, and it's going to continue through Jacob, almost despite himself. So yeah, praise God. God's not derailed by human messiness, right? God's plan, God's promise is not derailed by human messiness. And I don't know what situation you're in tonight, but if you're anything like me, you've got human messiness in your life, in your family, in your personal life, your work life, human messiness all over the place. It's an encouragement to me. So I'm doing application now, but it's an encouragement to me that God's plan and God's promises continue even through the messiness of human drama. I take that as a real encouragement. There's other themes that we could pull out, but I want to make sure we got at least one God theme out of this. These are good good moral lessons that are actually here and are good lessons. And but I wanted to pull a theological one out as well. So there's a theological one. Let's just take a minute to pray. Lord, yeah, thank you so much for this passage. And I pray that even now, Lord, you would speak to our hearts about what you want us to hear from this passage. God, I pray that your Holy Spirit would fill each heart and that you would speak to us what you want us to hear and what you want us to know and to carry with us as a result of this passage. I'd like you to take just a couple minutes right now and in a spirit of quietness before the Lord, listen to what he's saying to you and try to hear. And just have an open, not struggle with it, just have your spiritual ears open and listen to God and hear what is it, why did he want you to study this passage tonight? And when you think you've heard what God wants you to hear, start writing it out. So when we get to the application part of our study, there's an A, B, C, D that we use as an acronym to sort of help us think about application, right? Is there something that God wants us to accept, right? Is there a truth that we've sort of been resisting and he wants us to accept that it's true? Is there something God wants you to accept? Is there something that God wants you to believe? Is there a step of faith in your heart that he wants you to take? Is there something from this text that God wants you to confess? Or is there something in this text that God wants you to do? I think it's a really handy little acronym, although I don't always know the difference between accept and believe, but ABCD makes a lot of sense to me. So I can remember this acronym. Is there something God wants you to accept or to believe or to confess or to do? So for me, as I was praying over this, oddly enough, the thing that stood out to me was the idea that deception leads to a bad end. I always try to be honest. That's something that is important to me, to be honest and to be a person of integrity. But there are times when I'm dealing with difficult situations with people when I try to tell the truth, but not all the truth, right? Or be careful with the truth so I can sort of try to keep the peace with my words, right? I'm not usually doing it to try to manipulate people into doing something I want them to do. Other than I want there to be peace. So it's not uncommon for me to struggle with inside, how do I tell the truth without making the situation worse than it already is? But But the truth is, I am not God. I'm not omniscient. I don't know what the end is going to be. So every time I try to do that, I'm putting myself in the place of God, trying to sort of control the situation with my words. So I was sitting here praying and thinking, okay, and it's not a particular situation in my mind right now that in my life that's going on where that's applicable. So I don't know why God was saying that to me. Maybe it's something that's going to come up in the next few days. But what I really heard God saying to me was, tell the truth, tell the truth, tell the truth. So that was my application for the night. How about somebody else? What was God saying to you tonight through this passage?
I think God's telling me to bless my children. Mm. I feel like I talk about my children to other people, and I'm always, you know, building them up because I'm very proud of them and all that kind of stuff. But I don't necessarily tell them. I mean, I tell them, but not often enough. Definitely not often enough.
Very good.
I need to do that.
Praise God.
They're probably going crazy. Awesome. I'll go to my daughter, say something on the phone. She'll be like, are you okay? Mama?
Are you on crack?
What's going on? What happened? Are you dying?
This is the new normal. Very good. Somebody else. What did God say to you tonight?
For me, what stood out to me was I'm 51 years old, and it was just a few weeks ago that I was thinking about my own father, who lavishes me with his praise and love. But there are times where I worry about what will my father think. And I think to myself, I'm 51 years old. Why am I worrying about still what my father thinks? And what I took away from this passage was the need for a parent's approval is apparently a very common thing, even into one's advanced age, as evidenced by this passage.
Yeah.
And I think I should maybe just feel like, well, it's a common natural biblical thing to want your parents' blessing, and that's why I feel that way.
Yeah.
And secondly, I thought to myself, as a parent myself, this kind of makes me realize how important it is to a child to feel their parents' approval and blessing. And just like Sue was saying, I should be more purposeful in making sure that my own child knows how much I approve of things when that she does, and make sure to feel her, to make her feel secure in the blessing when she's, you know, doing the right things and going down the right road.
Very good. Yeah, thanks for sharing. That's great, Carol. That's great. Thank you also for not saying that 51 is an advanced age. I'm not ready for being in the main stage. Anybody else? Something that God's been saying to you tonight? Well, as always, no pressure. It's just sort of a free opportunity to share. Thank you for everybody who did share. And that's great. If you didn't share, I hope that God did speak to you tonight and that you take what he's spoken and you take it into your life this week and you take it into your prayer life this week. If you feel like God didn't speak to you tonight, take a little time tomorrow. Just read over the passage, close your eyes, unless you've studied it, right? It's not that there's nothing more to see, but just review it and open your heart to the Lord and say, okay, what is it you want to say to me? And if you don't hear anything from God tomorrow, then I'll open it up again. We're going to talk about a passage in a little while where Jacob wrestles with God until he gets a blessing, right? That's biblical, right? It's even if you don't hear from God the first time you listen again, right? Keep listening, keep wrestling with God until he gives you the blessing. It's a great Bible lesson, not to prejudge you for when we get there, but that's a great lesson from that passage that we can carry with us today. Let's close with a prayer. Lord, thank you for the blessing of the scriptures. Thank you for the blessing of each other as we study together. Thank you for the blessing of your Holy Spirit working in our hearts and helping us to see and know wonderful things in your word. And thank you that you don't abandon us, you don't leave us behind, but you are speaking to us even today. Thank you for your love for us. Thank you for your love for our children. And Lord, thank you for this reminder to bless our children. And thank you for this reminder that our children are not just natural born kids, but that we can bless younger people in our orbit who don't have our same last name. The craving for a parent's blessing can be fulfilled by anyone who we respect. And so I pray that you'd help us, Lord, to pass blessing on to those who we have some connection with. Help us to be a church filled with blessing. Help us to have families filled with blessing and to have lives that are looking to bless others. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Well, thanks for being with us tonight for this deep dive Bible study. I'm going to hit stop on the recording.
I just have a comment first.
Oh,
if your father was alive, I think he would feel very blessed to have a son like you who knows God's word so well and loves to preach from God's word, and he would be proud of you, and as I'm sure your mom is too.
Thanks, Beth. Thanks, Mom. I appreciate it.